TV English, the solution for humanity.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, and welcome to another episode in the series The Cross Question. And in this series we have been looking at how Christianity stands and falls on the cross. The death of Jesus, peace be upon him, according to Christianity on the cross, and the rising from the dead have formed the basis of Christianity. And no other religion in the world is so insecurely built around a single historical event. As Paul said in the Bible himself in 1 Corinthians chapter 15 verse 17, if Christ was not raised from the dead, your faith has nothing in it. And so in this series we have been looking at how we can prove how the crucifixion indeed, in fact, is very unreliable, as we found recorded in the pages of the Bible. We've been going meticulously through in the last few weeks, or in fact the last few months, at each single point leading up to the alleged Easter scene. And we have been going through all the different arguments being put forward by Christians to state that the crucifixion scene should be accepted. And so we have been analyzing and looking at each verse and showing that we cannot accept it, not just from a Muslim perspective, but if you're a Christian and you are seriously searching for truth, you have to ask yourself the question, what does the text actually have to say? And we've seen in this series how there have been more doubts than certainties. And now we are moving on, looking at what happened on that supposed fateful day of the crucifixion. What did the people see? Did they actually see anything? Who was on the cross according to the text? We have given a number of explanations of who it could be, other than what Christians assume or claim who it was that was on the cross, or who it was that gave the so-called sacrifice for their sins. And so last episode, we looked at a number of explanations of atonement. What was acceptable, what was not acceptable for the forgiveness of sins, and whether somebody in fact needed to be put on the cross in the first place for sins to be forgiven. Today we are going to continue. We're going to look at the book of Mark, and Mark chapter 15 and verse 42. And in Mark chapter 15 verse 42, it says that when evening came, it was time to take the body of the person who was on the cross off the cross. Now a man by the name of Joseph of Arimathea, an honorable counselor, went into Pilate and asked Pilate if he could take down the body of Jesus according to what the scriptures say in Mark chapter 15. And Pilate was amazed. In fact, the actual word that is used in the Bible is Pilate was marveled. He was surprised, as other versions say. But the King James says that Pilate marveled. He was basically flabbergasted. And so when they asked him if the body could be taken down, he sent a guard to go and check. He actually summons the centurions to go and see if the body in fact was dead. And then he gave the body over. Only after he had got confirmation, then he gave the body to Joseph. This is what we find narrated in Mark chapter 15 verse 42. Now, the underlying question is, why did he doubt that the body was dead? That Jesus was in fact dead. Well, the reason he questioned it is because there is such a short period of time that has passed, probably anywhere between 2 to 3 hours from the moment that the prophet Isa, peace be upon him, is allegedly, according to the Bible, placed on the cross to the moment that he bows his head and dies. And we've given lots of reasons why we doubt this scenario from taking place in previous episodes. So Pilate had to go and make confirmation from the centurion if this is indeed the situation. And so he goes and investigates to make sure that this actually takes place. So he wants confirmation that the body was dead. Or perhaps he wanted confirmation from the centurion. Remember last time we looked at how the centurion, the person was there, offered Jesus wine to drink that was laced with vinegar. Some say it was laced with myrrh. Some say it was a drug. Depends what version of the Bible you choose to read it from. And perhaps he wants to confirm with the centurion, not whether he is dead, but whether he is living. So there is no real confirmation given us in the pages of the Bible whether the centurion is going to actually tell him he is dead, or whether the centurion is actually going to tell him, yes, he is living, like we have prearranged beforehand. So we're not sure what the confirmation is. You can read into it, as the Christian does, that he was dead. Or you can quite easily, in exactly the same way, read into it that he is living. And so he has made this prearranged agreement that he's going to hand the body over to Joseph. You can read it either way. Just because you say it is so doesn't make it so. We have to read what the text says. And the text does not give any inclination that it was, in fact, the body is now 100% dead. We had no one coming and taking a pulse, no one taking a heart reading, no one checking the breath. So we have to take it on what we see in the text and the text alone. So it is notable that while Joseph, the person who requested, went in boldly to claim that the body is dead, no one else actually went to check this. We have no other reports that said that the body was in fact dead. The only narration that we have is from this man, Simon himself. Now, I'm not going to go into details who Simon is because we already did this two episodes before. So if you don't know what's going on, try to get hold of those earlier episodes and refresh yourself on what happened when we are speaking about this man, Joseph. So it seems that there may have already been, if we look at it from the skeptical point of view, a sequence of events that already took place to prevent this person from dying, if you rely on the text alone. Remember, this is not the view of Islam. It is not the view of Muslims. This is purely looking at what the text says and taking a translation or an interpretation from that text. Just as much as the Christian is using poetic license to interpret it in his own bias, there is just as much information for there to be skepticism on the way it is narrated and to claim that there was no such thing as a death, that he in fact was not dead. So we are not saying from a Muslim perspective this is what happened. We are just simply being demotivational. So often people say, what do you do for a living? And I say to people, I am a demotivational speaker. My job is to show the problems in the text, not to tell you that the text is correct, just to show you the issues that are just as acceptable. So it is a fruitless exercise to claim that you can be 100% sure that the text says this when the text is so vague in its writing. As we've looked at before, it seems to be an unfair sequence of events that took place for Jesus according to the narration that we find in the New Testament. First of all, someone else helps him carry his cross, where the other people are forced to carry the cross for themselves. Secondly, he is offered a drug to take so that he doesn't have to go through the pain. The other two do not get the same preferential treatment. Third, his legs are not broken. Again, getting preferential treatment, maybe in a way to help him survive, if we read it from a skeptic's point of view. And the fourth thing that we hear is that he is not nailed to the cross. He is bound to the cross, which gives the impression that he was tied and not nailed. Again, preferential treatment given. The only source that we have that mentions that he was nailed to the cross is that bit is not accepted in Christian literature from an external source that the Christians themselves will not accept and put into the Bible. So when we add all these things together, it makes you wonder. It makes you think, why all this preferential treatment? We as Muslims have a different text, so we don't have any of this nonsense to deal with. We don't have any of these problems. We don't have any of these criticisms thrown at Islam when we look at the situation of what happened with the Prophet Isa, peace be upon him. What about the people who were supposed to be those who are going to verify whether this man or whether Jesus, according to the Bible, was in fact dead? If the Jews were anxious to make sure that the Jesus of the Bible was killed, and also suspected at the same time that the disciples or his followers might become those type of people that will be involved in some type of foul play, perhaps some type of ploy to hide the body and pretend that he was in fact resurrected, surely they would have been anxious to make sure that they verified the death of this man who the disciples or the writers of the book of the New Testament or the books of the New Testament claim to be the Son of God. Surely the Jews who were so anxious to kill him, so anxious to see him dead on that specific day, why, we have no idea. What was the importance of that day? We still have no answer to that. If they were so determined, why are they not there to see the verification of his death? Strangely, this was the most important part of the crucifixion that they'd want to observe. Yet there is no one to identify whether this actually took place. The only person that we have is a centurion, and we have to, by extension, purely by extension, the text does not say this, but by extension of the fact that there is a centurion there, by extension, we have to accept that possibly there were soldiers that were also saying that he was dead. But other than that, in a Jewish confirmation sense, there is no one. There is only pagans who are saying this took place. The Jews themselves were not there to see what happened. Now the apologists, the Christian apologists, will give the simple statement. Of course they weren't there. They were preparing for the Passover, an extremely religious event. They would not want to have any blood on their hand. They would not want to be seen, even associated with anything closely relating death or pain or suffering. But if that is the case, why are they involved in the crucifixion scene at all? So you can't have it one way and then ignore the other. It's time for us to take a break, and when we get back from the break, we will continue, inshallah.
Muhammad, pearls of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. Abu Sa'id al-Khudri, may Allah be pleased with him, narrated that he heard the Prophet, peace be upon him, say, whoever amongst you notices something evil should correct it with his own hands, and if he is unable to do so, should prohibit the same with his tongue. If he is unable even to do this, he should at least consider it as bad in his heart. This is the lowest degree of faith. Sahih Muslim, Volume 1, Book of Faith, Chapter 21, Hadith Number 79.
Countries of the world ban bullying. They fight it in their schools and universities. A lot of us are being bullied differently every single day. Some come up to us and say, do this, while others say, don't you dare. Some say this is halal, halal, while others say, nope, this is haram. Haram. Are you confused? Are you confused? Do you feel lost? Join me in Umdatul Ahkam, where, with the grace of Allah, we will learn the proper knowledge from the Quran and from the Sunnah, which would help stop this kind of bullying.
Join Asim Al-Hakim in Umdatul Ahkam, next on Peace TV.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, and welcome back from the break. We are looking at this issue of the verification of death. According to the argument, There is confirmation that Jesus, peace be upon him, according to the Christians, is dead, because there was a centurion, and we said by default we allow in that there possibly were soldiers that also verified this fact. But outside of that, we have no other independent verification. No Jew was verifying that in fact Jesus was dead, and in fact they were the ones that demanded it. The Romans were not interested in having him crucified. In fact, they said they had found no guilt in this man. The pagans did not want him crucified. No one cared that he claimed to be the Son of God. No one cared that even if he claimed that he was an astronaut, and they didn't even know what that meant. They didn't care because they were pagans. They had hundreds of gods. They had hundreds of people that they saw as sons of God. They saw many people as demigods or gods. They didn't care what this man said about himself being a Messiah or whether he is a god at all. The Jews were the ones concerned. So why were they not verifying what happened? The apologists, like we said before the break, will say this is illogical for you even to bring up this point, because it was Passover and they would have not wanted anything to do with this blood and this gore and all the rest that was happening on this fateful day. So it's stupid for you, Arib, to even bring it up. Well, if it is stupid for me to bring it up, then why were they involved in the entire crucifixion scene in the first place? Why were they outside the courtyard saying, crucify him, crucify him, put the blood on us? We want the blood of this man on us and on the future generations to come. These are the same people that your argument says, not wanting to get anything on them, not wanting to have any defilement on them on the day of Passover. Yet just 4 hours ago, they were screaming and pleading for the blood of this man to be on them and to condemn future generations of Jews all the way through to today. It doesn't make any sense. You can't have it one way and not another. We have to apply simple mathematics, and I know I'm scaring away a lot of Christians by saying the word mathematics. We have to have simple math. What you do to the one side, you have to do to the other. As we've said before, in Christian mathematics, 1 plus 1 can equal 742.3, but to all the rest of the world, it equals 2. Mathematics is not a good subject when it comes to Christianity, as we've seen already in this series. So the soldiers are left to be the only people that were credible supposed witnesses to the fact to ensure whether Jesus is actually dead or stayed alive. They're the only ones. If we look at the conspiracy theory from the pagans' perspective, from the Romans' perspective, why do we keep saying that perhaps the Romans had a vested interest to keep Jesus alive? What was the point of them keeping Jesus alive? If we look at it according to the Roman perspective, some people will be confused. Maybe you are watching the other episodes and say, where can you come up with this theory? Where do you get this from? Well, who were the two options that were offered as people to be crucified on that specific day? There was Jesus the Christ, and there was Jesus Barabbas. These were the two Jesuses that were offered for crucifixion on that day. Jesus Barabbas would not have been released by the Romans under any circumstance whatsoever, no matter how many Jews screamed and shouted, crucify the other Jesus, crucify him, crucify him, crucify him. Why is that? Because Jesus Barabbas was a known terrorist. And so as this known terrorist, he would have been on the top wanted list. He was number one on the list of terrorism. He was someone who had caused sedition. He had encouraged people to kill in the name of Judaism, to become in modern day times a suicide bomber. He was a person who was on the wanted list. He was on the no-fly list. He had quadruple S on the front of all his tickets whenever he wanted to travel. This man would have never been released by the Romans, not in a trillion years. He was a person who had already killed a Roman official. He was telling the Jews to fight up and kill the Romans. Do you really believe? Is there any way possible that he could possibly have been released? So this is why we are saying there is a vested interest in preserving Jesus of Nazareth, Jesus the son of Mary. If we look at it from what you're giving us in the text, from a textual understanding of what we see, there is no chance that they are going to kill this Jesus, the biblical version. They're going to keep him alive, and they're going to assassinate, whether publicly or privately, Jesus Barabbas. In fact, if they have not already put him on the cross, and that's the person who's actually on the cross at this point in time. We are not saying this happened. These are just many, many theories that we can throw forward that are as credible as the ones that you are trying to show us in the pages of the Bible. The narrative that we find in Islam makes absolute simplicity. It's so logical. Inshallah, if we have time in the series, we'll go into that. But at this point, the verification of death scenario again fails all the tests that are put against it when we look at it from a point of view as an outsider, not as a Christian. So from the point of view of an outsider, when we read the text, he is not dead, he is alive. Now, if we look at the sequence that happens next, the body is taken down. But there is something that is required both in Judaism and in Islam. It has been a requirement of Jews and Muslims all along. It's a requirement that will be both in Judaism and Islam until this world is no longer in existence and it is snapped out and every light is switched off and there's nothing left on planet Earth. It will remain a requirement. When a person dies, none of the Gospels that we read in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John record this event taking place. And it is the simple fact that the body was given a ritualistic bath before burial. Not a Jew would ever bury an individual person, no matter how close the Sabbath was, no matter how close sunset was to taking place, without giving it this bath, without wrapping the body properly, and preparing it in the ritualistic way that is supposed to be done, according to Judaism, right through to this very, very day. And this would be very, very important to a Jew. There is no ways that they would have buried the Prophet Isa, peace be upon him, according to the Christian dialogue, according to the Christian tradition, according to the Christian writing, that he would have been buried without this. Not a possible thing to be done. Unless, of course, we want to go according to a very, very credible theory that we've been looking at so far, and we look at the pagan influence on this situation, and we say the pagan Romans knew all along that whoever this person was, that he was not in fact dead, and that he was going to stay alive. Then it makes sense that they do no bathing. Then it makes sense that he is alive, and he is not giving a ritualistic bath. You see how easy it is for us to look at the text and come up with another theory simply on it. We are not agreeing that that is what happened. But from reading the text, this is what we see. We see not a conspiracy, but a very likely sequence of events. It is very difficult to convince people otherwise when we read this text. The other important thing that we see is that we have very little time left in the program today, but I'm just going to touch on it briefly. All three of the synoptic gospels, being Matthew, Mark, and Luke. John, remember, he is on a playground all by himself, and he doesn't like to play with the rest of the children. He wants to do things on his own. So we're leaving him on the side because even Christians find it difficult to accept his version of Jesus as found in the pages of the Bible. Because remember, he tries to make Jesus out to be something like a Thor, like a demigod with tremendous amounts of supernatural powers and superhuman strength. But if we listen to the synoptic gospels, which give a normal portrayal of who Jesus the Christ or Jesus the Son of Mary is, may Allah be pleased with him, they give a sort of more acceptable, more digestible version. We see that even those gospels, when they talk, they speak in a more simplistic way. Next time, we are going to be talking about the spices that were prepared for the embalming or the preparation of the body. This is something very interesting. So make sure you tune in again next episode, same time, with me, Arif Islam. So until next time, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
of worship and the vigil in the night of power.
Ramadan, which is the topic of the show. Do you have any advice for our viewers?
Asad Ahmad.
Especially in the blessed month of Ramadan.
The Ramadan is the reminder of rectifying our behavior.
Dr. Ali Ali Shaban.
Ramadan is a unique opportunity for every Muslim.
And the reasons behind this revelation and its power emphasized. As the human heart transcends towards godly glory.
If you apply Ramadan to the rest of the year,
Tariq Ali.
Surely you are going to be much, much better in all fields, all aspects.
And the gratitude of the soul reaches out to worship the Almighty One on this esteemed night.
Just to stick more and more of Zayim to the Holy Quran.
Dr. Muhammad Ibrahim.
This is my advice to all my Muslim brothers.
Let's strive to seek the might of power and its bliss in Blessed Nights every Friday at 4:30 p.m. and repeat telecast at 3:30 a.m. UK on Peace TV.
What would you recommend?
Peace TV presents.
What do you have to say about
learning the wise way?
What would you recommend us to take as career
after we pass our school? So what exactly we should do?
What do you have to say about pursuing two fields together?
Ideas brilliant, strategy sustained.
The best profession is a profession of a person who invites people to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
Avail the opportunity with Dr. Zakir.
Depending upon what is your interest. But the main aim should be to spread the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
To implement the convincing Islamic cum educational formula to excel in your career. Watch Career Guidance every Friday at 6:30 p.m. and repeat telecast at 9:30 a.m. UK on Peace TV. The value of money in the hereafter will be measured by its proper use in the present.
Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu anfiqoo mimma razaqnakum min qabli an ya'tiya yawmun la bay'un fihi wa la khullatun wa la shafa'a.
According to the glorious Quran, one of the best ways to use your money is to spend it in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by spreading His message of Islam. Peace TV is a non-profit Islamic satellite television channel that is primarily dedicated for just that cause, the proper presentation of Islam. It's a great choice to invest in it and a golden opportunity to purify your wealth in a way that pleases Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
Support Peace TV. Send your zakat and donations to IRFI Al Rayan Bank, 47 Calthorpe Road, Birmingham, UK. B151TH. Pound account number 01132301. IBAN GB49ARAY 3000830113230 1. Sort code 300083. SWIFT BIC code ARAY GB22. Please confirm your contribution at support@peacetv.tv.
Support Peace TV, the solution for humanity.